So then you find that to be the case. Well, let's just get into this because we didn't touch on NASO this in 2012. We didn't put anything up on the channel for NASO. And NASO, we called it WSSED. WSSED. WSSED means to take. WSSED means to take. Instead, this particular 35th sabbatical week, 2012, we focused more on, as you know with the recent videos, we focused more on the eye, the Illuminati eye, the so-called Queen of England, Bloody Jubilee, the prophetic signs in Babylon, and what the scripture says to this vis-a-vis the kingdom of the King of Kings and his Christ. This is what we've been focusing on, and even the prophecy in Zephaniah, woman of wickedness, so forth and so on. So some might be like, oh, what happened to this week's portion, reading and feeding? Well, if you go and look up NASO, write the name NASO within the search for this channel, Ethiopian World Net, you will find that we already have a portion that we posted on NASO. So this is just to kind of do a quick review of that, and also to indicate to ones in the future, should we not maybe focus on a particular Torah portion of reading and feeding, that one should have the personal responsibility. You see, this is what the true covenant and the true birthright is about. It's about taking that personal responsibility, and in taking that personal responsibility to study up, to read, and if you're familiar with that portion, you could maybe focus a little more on the Haftarah portion or the New Testament portion, reading and feeding, and basically just enjoy the Shabbat. You always tend to have joy in the Shabbat and to remember, you understand, the Shabbat and to keep it set apart. And therefore, if you remember the Shabbat, the Senbet, whichever Sabbath it is and whichever particular reading or feeding it is, whether one reads it on that day or not. Now, in community, it's a little bit different. Why I say it's different? Because we're in common unity. We are living in community. And this is also why we posted on the land grant some vids on the Google Earth. The Shashamani land grant, the Jamaican Sefer, and which means the Jamaican camp, so to speak, or area, you can say, the Jamaican area, which originally was part of the Ethiopian World Federation Sefer. But knowing the history, you can understand basically the record from different perspectives of what happened that have led to the present state of the Federation today, to be as diplomatic about this very sensitive issue as possible. We've said this before, that in order for the Federation, the Ethiopian World Federation, to truly be what it was meant to be, we also must be bigger than we have ever been, and meet the challenges, this ultimate challenge according to the teaching of His Majesty, which is what we're seeking to do in this run-up, so to speak, to the Exodus. To first of all, to prepare our hearts and to prepare our minds with the half of the story that we have, and we cannot go off half-cocked, so to speak, all right? But being what it is, let's deal with the WSSED. So we still have some of the information up here from the previous portion, and it's been up here almost all week. And today, let's just clear this up as much as possible. We're going to take this down so we can put up some other important notes. Now, there's a couple of subject matters that we want to address, all right, before the next sabbatical, or to prepare us for the next sabbatical. Now, there are, we have to use the rubbing alcohol on some of that. You know, when you leave it up there, it kind of gets a little embedded. It might look from your view over there, it might look pretty clear, but we can see the farmer riding up here. But be that as it may, you understand? If it doesn't come out in the wash, it'll come out in the rinse. So this is RSS, just a review. RSS number 35, number 35, right? Number 35, and its name is NASO, right? And this is with said, right? And NASO means to lift up, right? In the Hebrew, to lift up. And with said means to take, right? To take. Like lift up and to take. Or to lift, taking something up. Now, NASO, which is the Masoretic Hebrew, this word being Hebrew is Afro-Shemitic. That means that there is an etymological linguistic connection with the so-called language of the Bible, the Textus Receptus, speaking of the Masoretic Hebrew, and the Ethiopic, because Ethiopic is that root language. I think we've seen a Law and Order episode recently. Forget which, what was the name of it or whatever. But in this episode, there was some killer running around, and he was writing Syriac. He was writing Syriac. Actually, he wrote a portion of the Song of Songs of Song of Songs of Solomon in Syriac, and over the place where he abducted or some kind of crime was committed, and it was a portion that spoke about how the maiden in Song of Songs, how she sought the beloved and could not find him on her bed. She sought him, whom my soul loved. Where are you? Almost like, where you're hiding at? I'm looking for you. I'm looking for you, yo. You know, where you're hiding at. I mean, it's a beautiful love story. And those who want to check out a little bit more, this is Song of Songs of Solomon right here. We didn't touch on this, but a theater. This is like Tiatia Theater. You know, a great people deserves great art, you know. And personally, this is probably what my calling in that sense, you know, with the linguistics and language, to be like the Ross Spear, so to speak. But anyway, we just want to point this out, Song of Songs. It's interesting that in that particular episode that was used. If you're interested, and this was particularly for the sisters, and we want to post something for a message to the Rastafari Ethiopic Sisterhood, or the Ethiopic Sisterhood of the Rastafari. Very, very important, as Matthew teaches us that the African woman, the righteous black woman, is so vital to our success, so vital to our liberty, being that mother and being of that mother of all living. And this is one of the reasons why in the particular series of videos, the theme seems to be from a general perspective. If one is not looking at the detail, just saying woman, bad woman, woman of wickedness, and even the Rihanna clip, and it's interesting, she's been in the news too. It wasn't to, you know, point to her in particular, you know what I mean? But she has been used in particular to project this particular image, and this is all leading to a prophetic manifestation of events that we need to know about. And we need not to waive our divine rights nor our divine heritage, and to recognize in that divine heritage that there are hidden, you know, there are hidden elements that Jah has hidden within the scrolls and the scriptures for us, for I and I, his people. But if we will not be faithful to even learn and become familiar and grow in our faith, we won't find it. And I use the example of the new technology now, where a lot of this new technology have a lot of hidden stuff that hackers know about. It's almost similar with the scriptures. The scriptures also have hidden elements within it, you understand, for God's people. For God's people, they think and they feel in a certain way. You see how black folks, so-called niggers, you know, Negroes or N-words, we're so unique as a people, you understand? I mean, for better, but unfortunately right now, the manifestation seems to be for worse. But being that as it may, today is Flag Day, which is kind of interesting. Today is Flag Day, right? We're recording this on June 14th, 2012, or 6/14, 2012, right? And we just published yesterday on 6/13, 2012, the legends of Our Lady, or I call it LOL, the legends of Our Lady, the Ethiopic legends of Our Lady, the Perpetual Virgin, and her mother Hannah, and her mother Hannah. And that particular scroll or document, I think, is really vital for all of the sisters, for all the sistren and all the sisters. There's much in the scrolls, Torah, but usually it was the males who studied the Torah. And this, we're not saying that sisters cannot. And we're not saying that there needs to be a Yento movement among the Rastafari sisters, because we're not that people, or we're not those Jews. You understand? We are these Yehuda, Moa Anbesa Ze'ema Negeda Yehuda, children of the conquering line of the tribe of Judah. But we'll get more into that in a moment. So if you want a little bit, another perspective of this, we'll went into a little bit more detail. Just make reference to some of the older videos or the previously posted videos, like last year's video on NASO. So put in the third of the names that you see in on the chart, right? NASO, once you are up to date with the order of things, put that in the search, and you should find a video that we've touched on that issue, and we try to touch on each of these particular parsha or portions in a basic summary sense, not getting into all the hidden apps, you know, all the hidden applications within the scriptures, what's often called Kabbalah, or might be called Mishnah or Gemara. These are processes or techniques. You know, techniques were made or developed for a particular reason. And techniques in the Bible is called wisdom. That's what, when we see wisdom in the scripture and we talk about technical or techniques today, that is what we're talking about. So you have to see these two words. So like from here, it's from an Ethiopic, wisset. And here is from the Hebraic or the later Masoretic, traditional, when Christ talked about the tradition of the Jews, you understand, or the Jewish Judaic tradition of the first century. When we're studying these Torah portions, readings and feedings, this is what we're becoming familiar with. So we're studying this, like Christ says, observe what they observe, but don't do after their works. So this is exactly what we're seeking to deal with here. So this is basic boot camp. You understand? This is basic boot camp. I mean, I know a lot of ones want to, you know, show I and I their feelings, you know, in the sense of how strongly they feel for this work, and we give thanks for that. But first get through boot camp. You know what I'm saying? First get your house in order, talking about your mind, your heart and mind, so you're familiar with what's really there, and allow the Holy Spirit to impart into you according to His order. You know, His Majesty says, for my part, I glory in the Bible. So for I and I, of the Society of His Imperial Majesty, the Lion Jew Society, and those of our faith-based fellows, others who in the Tawahido faith, who think accordingly, one who dismisses the Bible as a relevant authority to be studied, and the truth to be found in it, to become approved to God as a workman. You see that? Study and show yourself approved. So there's some basic steps that we need to take. And time and prophecy continues to unravel and manifest every single day. And occasionally we get to touch on this or that or some particular where the Holy Spirit points our direction and give us the evidence, you know, and the proof. You know what I'm saying? We're presenting that to you, not just like, okay, that's Babylon being Babylon, but it's also showing us how they are doing their father's will. And Christ says that their father is not our father, like saying their pope, in other words, is not our papa and not our Abba, you know, and their father, you understand, is Satan, Yetaregame Yuhun, you understand, the devil and the Menafikan, you understand, the Kahadiwoj, the deniers, and all of those unseemly rebels, But scripturally speaking, it breaks down very, very systemically. You know, but we have to become wise to what's here so we can see this in real time, in the real application. Once you begin to see this word, you understand, and it's studied truth in real time, then one can truly say one is seeing it Jah's way. You understand? When you don't look at it your way or the way you used to look at it, you understand, from a worldly orientation, but now you look at it from the orientation of the King of Kings and his Christ. So this whole process that we have been going over in the Udot, in the cycles, in the yearly Torah portion reading and feedings, has a double, you know, there's a double point to it. You understand? There's like a double blessing in a sense also in it. It's first of all giving us a familiarity and shining the light of the half of our story. But it's also preparing us for real-time moves that we have to make both individually and initially individually. Even in faith, it's the individual that must come to that acceptance, the individual who must count the course and check themselves. You understand? And what happens in disorientation is one looking for a group or looking for other ones because they still are unsure and uncertain. So this gives us a groundation and a foundation. The Torah portion, readings and feedings. And there are some who try to, dissemblers and evil talkers who try to say, oh, it's just talk. You're just talking about these things. We need to be about action. We need to do things and do. And they don't know what they're doing. They don't know who they are. You understand? They are making their own righteousness. You know, they have a zeal. They have zeal. They have passion. But like Paul says, it is ignorant. It is without the knowledge, and we already seen that. We've been there, actually. We've done that already, and we have this testimony. But you notice this is the common denominator. They avoid these testimonies. Or if they touch on the Bible, that's all they do. They touch on the Bible. You know what I'm saying? They don't really get baptized. They don't get deep into the Word and pray and meditate and really ask God to open up their eyes so that which they don't understand in here, they begin to understand and even see within the real life. That means they're looking at the real world. That means they've been unplugged at that particular point. People say, well, I don't know if I've been unplugged. You understand? When you start to see things Christ's way, you still know how you would have thought about it or what you would have done, but now you see Christ's testimony. Then the decision is there. You understand? Are you going to continue to follow Christ or are you going to do it your own way or another way? You understand? And that's what shows are called. Chosen. You understand? One who hears a call. Some folks are here, but they haven't checked on, was I called? You understand? And even if you don't recall if you was called, pray to be of those called so you can really choose. That's why you can't choose, because you still have problems with the call. You understand? You can't choose. And then to be faithful at each step is personal responsibility. So being in a group or of a group, so forth and so on, which we've been doing over and over, trying to have a big old jamboree and maybe try to do a party or a dance. And nothing wrong with having a musical, like a gathering or you know, some sort of, I wouldn't call it party, but maybe feast or, you know, celebration or something. There's nothing wrong with that. But we're looking to unite at those things. You know, while we got other educational issues we need to deal with, and we can deal with it. You understand? Whether we're working a 9-to-5 or 5-to-9 or whatever like that, there's still the opportunity to get our house in order. And in speaking on that, in connection right here, this part speaks of the order of Jah's host. It speaks of the service. So this particular portion that we have right here in NASO, right, Nessa, like Tenessa, Tensaye, you understand? And this is the Ethiopic, but the root part is Nessa, Nesha, Nessa. You understand? The lifting up, the raising up, right? So it has the idea of to take, right? The idea in the Hebrew is to take. Now, Ethiopic speakers, you understand, ones who speak Amharic, at least understand if you say Yenessa, right, if you say Yenessa, Tenestoa, You understand? You understand that this is the idea of lifting up, or even implied in as a state of resurrection, comes from that same root word. So this is, as we study it, we begin to now uncover these elements. It's like a seed planted in a good, willing, receptive heart and mind. It starts gradually as you water it. You see, and the Shabbat waters it, our prayers water it, fellowship waters it, all the things that the scripture is showing us in different areas. And this is why we, in the ministry, we're trying to put certain things forward in a way that refers one to scriptures, but trying to avoid the whole catechism thing. And maybe this is a personal thing. Maybe John wants I and I to form a basic catechism, but I'm trying to avoid the catechism, you know, just the question and answers on a certain level, which sometimes ones rely on, and therefore they'll go to like the cliff notes. Excellent examples in college. You have a class, biology or physics or whatever. It could be theater, drama, whatever. And what you do, you go get the cliff notes, which basically gives you a synopsis of the story. And most folks don't do the work during the year or the semester. And then at the end, they know the test is coming up, so they get a, like this right here is a good example right here. I just see something that I want to use as an example right here. We got this right here. This is Through the Bible Radio, J. Vernon McGee. This right here, as you can see, it's Hebrews, right? This is Hebrews right here. And you can see you can put it on a little notebook right here, right, with the holes right there. And this is this book, right? And it has basic, simple, you know, simple summaries, right? Where this is found, where that is found, what this is about, how that refers to this. And this is excellent. This is excellent. The problem is the lack of discipline that one will get this, or they know a test is coming up. They'll get this to pass the test, right, in order to have the assessment, really. But they really haven't gone into the work. While, instead of using this to actually look up these areas and take the time to pray and just meditate and keep it in your head and heart and meditating to muddle on it, to turn it over and over and over again, they don't do that. So therefore, when they're in the actual situations, you'd be like, well, wow, you scored so high on the assessment test, but I don't really see the fruit. You see, they're not really accountable. Connecting once again to numbers, all is number, Plato says, and he was educated in Egypt, and Egypt was a colony of ancient Ethiopia. So it makes sense that why that verse is so true. You'll say, because it's a hand-me-down, in other words. Once again, going to Numbers, the book of Moses, the fourth book of Moses called Numbers. Let's go over what it says here once again, so you can understand what's in this book. It is the book of service. It's the book, we can call it the book of ministry. And so we've been occupying I non-recording time. I got that message about do I and I sleep, you know, and I was going to do a little skit to that or whatnot like that. But I always what you're saying, you know, in that sense. But I and I have been sleeping, you know, many of I and I have been sleeping most of our lives, more, you know, in that sense, as far as rest. Get rest and to meditate. I and I seek and try hard to practice, you know, these things that I and I preach. I say, why should some of y'all or all of y'all get the benefit? And as Huari Paulo says, I be disqualified. You know, I and I help you. I should try to do it myself. You'll say, I should do it. You cut out that try right there. Do it, I and I self. So, yes, give thanks, beloved, for those comments and others who've made good comments. Try to maybe link to our website or something, or maybe we'll have to have some sort of a repository of those things, so when we do get more rest time, we can go over it and maybe touch on some of the questions and other issues that we didn't touch on previously. But right now, Book of Numbers, Rastafari, Sabbatical Study number 35, so we're going to put this up here as this title, and when this goes up here with this title, it's probably going to connect with the other vid, the former vid that we already had did from, I think, last year, if not the year before as well. This is about the third or so year that we have been doing this particular fellowship studies and broadcasting it to our brothers throughout the world. and sisters throughout the world. So this is a book of service and walk, in other words, like conduct, and thus completes with the preceding books a beautiful moral order. And we touched on the moral theocracy, right? Genesis is the book of the creation and fall. Exodus is of redemption. Leviticus is of worship or worship and fellowship. And Numbers of that which should follow, service and walk. So what's explaining is that if we take from the beginning, after the Simchat Torah or the joy in Jah's law, the eighth day, right, and we begin to study every Shabbat and we go through all of these books within a cycle, a orbit, right, within a so-called earth year or rotation. We touch on the book of creation and the fall of Adam, right, and those brothers and sisters who have ordered this book, I wanted to make a mention of this before. So I know there's a lot of other subject matters I'm including here because all connected, and those who can receive it, hallelujah, give thanks, you receive it. To the others, pray. Right here, so this is the Gedla Adam, and we want to touch on this particular book here as well. This is the Gedla Adam. It's very, very interesting because it gives us other known information from that particular time. And this is why in the Bible people say, well, the Bible doesn't go all into detail. Because people in that time, they knew these things. It's like when you're writing to your friend about what's going on nowadays, or you're talking to somebody about something that's happening. You might write a big, long essay or whatever, but you don't explain all the background. Because people say, I know that already. I just want to know what's your opinion about this or that. They don't want all that background because these are things that are current today. We have to go into that background because it's been suppressed. It's been distorted. It's been misrepresented, so a lot of us probably have come across it, but because we didn't know really who we were, we didn't grasp it. So, you know, in other words, we didn't take it, we didn't lift it up, right? There's a point about lifting up and NASO, the word I want to make mention of. But first Genesis is the book of creation and fall, and Exodus is of redemption. Leviticus is now of worship of the, remember, this is after the golden calf. And those who did not bow, you understand, to the false idols, to the false gods, or to the those who did not regurgitate, those who did not retrograde. That's what happened. It's almost like we come out of this, right, and we go to the promised land, and niggas still trying to live like niggas and worship the false gods. It's that kind of madness. That's what the golden calf symbolized. Like, we already been there. We done that. And instead of being patient with Jah and with Moses, you know what I'm saying, we went backward instead of trusting. Instead of, if the Israelites in the mixed multitude was meditating, if they were praying and going about what they should do and just you know, be patient but pray, meditate, you know, like work and pray. Pray and work is the motto for the real community. If they prayed and worked, you understand, then they wouldn't have been worrying about, oh, Moses is not back yet. Wow, John must really be giving him something. We must got a blessing here. Word. So let's just keep on, carry on. But no, they was like, oh, man, we need somebody to do some religious stuff here. And that's why I think we've been doing that same thing here in the diaspora, especially among Rastafari, a lot of that nice, pseudo-religious, rah-rah-rear-rear stuff. And it's time for us to kind of get off that childishness. It's like children, you know, like when children are playing and they try to put on their parents' clothing and stuff like that, and they're like, I'm mama, I'm papa, and so forth and so on. You know, it's almost like we've been doing that on a certain level. Well, it's time to kind of grow up. We should be past Rastafari kindergarten, you understand, and maybe daycare. It's also like the kindergarten / daycare. You know, now we have to get into elementary school, and this is what the Torah teaching, readings, and feedings are for. But there's a personal responsibility in order to really receive it. You know what I mean? The order here shows us now we are at the point of what Numbers speaks of. And I said that Numbers, the idea is accountability. Because when you understand Numbers, like, do you like Numbers? No, for real. I mean, and this is not a judgment. This is not no. It is a judgment. It's not a condemnation point by asking this. Do you like Numbers? How do you like Numbers? I know different folks, some people are like, yo, I love Numbers. Some people are like, I just use them. They use them as much as, but they, because maybe they've had challenges growing up, and and maybe didn't grasp the idea. So sometimes when we hear a word, we already have a preset programming towards this word, and we have to take all of that into consideration as well. If John says this in his word, and his word is going, then you say, well, I really don't like that. Do you even know why you don't like that? Have you really meditated and meditated the value of your disagreeableness? You know, I mean, really, I mean, okay, you might not like it, but do you not like it because it's not good or because of what? You know, these are the kind of meditation things we have to do, and it's not for I or next one to tell one. One should seek these things out, and it really comes out to honesty and truth. It comes down to that point of honesty and truth. You know what I mean? It's like the Lauryn Hill had the song, and pray for Lauryn Hill, brothers and sisters. Pray for her. I think she's targeted. They're targeting I and I, sister Lauryn Hill. Those who can do videos and know how to edit some videos, whatever, just do some videos just encouraging, you know, the faithful, the righteous, to pray for the sister here, because we see what they do to ones who resist. You understand? It's clear that she has shown that resistance to the evil, negative influences of this shitstem, Yovas, and they're trying to target her on some spurious taxes, or she hasn't been paying taxes. Really, it's because she had not been making more money for them. She made a certain amount, and she received the royalties off of that. Now they're saying she's not paying taxes, boom, 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 and she's about to go up before. You probably hear it in the news. You know what I'm saying? Come on, just pray for that. Honestly, let's pray for that sister for real. You understand? And the brothers and sisters who this word reaches, no. The others, well, you know, so be it right there. But what were we saying? Let's just continue with this. We'll type, because some of those are other areas that it kind of goes into. And I think once you get the, you know, I hope you can get the idea. You understand? So not being judgment, not being condemnational, not judging against you, but judging in favor of the truth. So if they lied to God, that's the point about Lauryn Hill. If they lied to God, right? If they lied to God, what makes you think they won't lie to you or me? So if ones don't trust Jah enough, God, His Majesty, it's like if you receive it in the name of a righteous man, you get a righteous man's reward. If you receive the name of a disciple, you get a disciple's reward. We receive it in the name of the King of Kings, so we seek the King of Kings and His Christ's reward. If they lied to God, what makes you think they won't lie to you or me? And if ones cannot trust Jah to at least, you know, learn of it and study it, because some people learn something but learn it ignorantly. They don't study it and maybe find out, oh, I was looking at it that way, but it really didn't mean that. But that's how they connotate the word. That's how they twist the word. The real meaning of it is this. Now it makes so much sense. Imagine how much freedom. That's freedom. But you don't have this baggage of ignorance. Ignorance is a heavy, heavy load. It is. You don't see it in this world because it's psychical, but it exists. There's substance to it. In other words, it is important to see that nothing was left to self-will. So this is what this book points to, the book of Numbers. So if one says, well, I like numbers, you know, a book like this and the whole idea of the divine order of numbers becomes very interesting. Some call it sacred geometry, you know, and have the pi and the phi, so forth. So we got a new offering that we're putting forward, and it actually touches on numbers. You understand? On the idea of numbers. You understand? And so we now come to the fourth book, and at the fourth book, accountability is called into order. You understand? So at this particular stage, as we are growing, we have to ask ourselves, if we were the Beit Israel in that situation, not in this one, but in that situation, how well accountable would we be? Would we have done the golden calf thing already? Or would we be like those who have bowed to the golden calf, the bling bling and all of that stuff, and kind of bowed to this false god after everything else that has been shown to us? It's so interesting. Will we still be allowing Africa to become gentrified. People talk about gentrification. They want to keep Brooklyn or some other black neighborhood black and still having white people. Like white people got no, European foreign nationals have no rights in those. I mean, but we already know how they get down. It's so silly. What about our promised land? That's what we should be concerned with about gentrification. You know what I'm saying? About investment, about the future. But how can we do that if we don't have no order? And how can we have a true order, which we all will willingly make our wills agreeable to the good influences of what order and unity can, if we don't have a spirit of the core. The spirit of the core for I and I is the Holy Spirit. You understand? So we have to remember when Christ prayed for the Holy Spirit to come for them, and he also prayed that they would stay in the upper room. Like, you understand, the upper room. In other words, stay in the mind state, the mind of Christ. This is what we have to ride over, you understand, mind over matter, over those emotional, unstable states. You understand? You know, it's like, I give thanks for ones who once want to, you know, reason and love what I and I may be seen to be doing. This is with the Holy Spirit using I and I as an instrument. Yes, I and I is a part of this, but really benefit from it and grow. It's not about so much some of the things that ones and ones have said, and it's not to be insulting or nothing like that, brothers and sisters. Before you even make up your mind on it, pray on it. You understand? What does the Holy Spirit, the King of Kings and His Christ, say to you about this? You understand? And that's what ones have to do. So it's nothing left to self-will. And why and I see among Rasta and Rastaism, and for the past 40 or so years, a whole generation is passing before I and I eyes, a lot of the elders, so forth and so on. It's not to even get into any personal invectives, what we didn't like. Yeah, we can, I say, write about it. You know, if we have these kind of what you're going to chit-chat, so forth, so write about it. Put it, and if you're not willing to put it on paper and memorialize it, keep it to yourself. You understand? Because a lot of that takes us away, in a sense, from what we should. We know that they have, to some extent, fallen short of the fullness of His will, getting caught up on self-will, but that should be a lesson for us. You know, so look at those pictures of Ethiopia, of Shashamani. If you haven't seen it, go check out some of those clips of Shashamani from the Google view. You understand? We should be right now seeking diplomatic overtures, you understand, to the authorities that be. But how can we do that if we're not in our proper person? And so we say that's one of the short-term things to do, right? Then we have the intermediate, and then we have the long-term. So the vision of Jah here is giving us the long term, but it's also showing us what we need to do in the short term. And so right now, the message for Numbers is, how are we on the level of service, of ministry, and our walk? You understand? Our ministry and our walk. Are we being moved by our self-will? You understand? Or are we making our wills obedient to His good influence, to His Holy Spirit, with knowledge of His word and faith in His Son, our black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, Hittachi and Jesus Christos. It says right here, every servant was numbered. In other words, that's to say, interpreted, every servant was accountable. Every servant was accountable. So the idea of numbers, because it says to take up, and let's just read the verse right here. It's 4:21, Numbers 4:21. 4:21 says this, and it reads, and this is the order of the host, and here is speaking of the service of the Gershonites. The Gershonites. Speaking of the service of the Gershonites. And Yahweh spake to Moshe, saying, take. See, that's what we have take right here in the English, right? Also the sum of the sons of Gershon throughout the houses of their fathers by their families. Now, notice how it says that every servant. So what we're getting right here is the numbering. Remember, number, right? Number, in the sense of number or numbers, really equals counting. You understand? The idea of counting, but really, in the overstanding, it's speaking of accountability. That spells it correct? Accountability. It's speaking about our accountability. Because counting, right, you're counting something else. Now, one is being accountability. Accountable. Like the counter is accountable, and the thing counted is the thing counted. It's accounted for. It has now been accounted for. So we're getting the numbering of what? The numbering of the host. H-O-S-T. But H-O-S-T, in some of your Bibles, it probably has A-R-M-Y. It probably has army. Right? Army. Because the host of Sarawit is, and it says Sara means to work, to make. Also, if you look at it, it's Sarah. You understand, from Egypt, it's like son of God, in a sense. It's, and that's interesting because through our big brother, Yeshua HaMashiach, our black Lord and Savior, we have become, through him and through the faith in him and that righteousness and grace that we receive, we have come back into the family. You understand, the family of God in Christ. So this also connects with the name, what we've been saying on being in our proper, in propitia persona sujuris. In our proper person, getting out of this artificial status, and therefore also outside of artificial jurisdiction, so forth and so on, because in order for us to move forward, that's one thing that's stopping folks from moving forward, because having these false names, European enslaved names, they're not just slave names, they are enslaved names, because here we say that slave names in a certain sense, you know, when we start to really now meditate on this, it almost implies that, yeah, they were slaves. No, they were enslaved. You see, really, I think people are more our lost sheep people. Sheep are more slaves today than they were in chattel slavery, which is kind of a whole other reasoning and discussion, or just simply individually a meditation, if you will. So we have the numbering here. So it says to take or to lift up. Now, there's a verse that you all know that the Lord giveth, right, and the Lord taketh away. You're familiar with that, right? You've heard that before. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. If I'm correct with this, and I'm very sure I am, I just looked it up the other day, in the Amharic, it says the Lord giveth, yiset al, like yiset alim, yinesalim. And that was interesting because I thought it would have take, like wisset. You see what I'm saying? Or wesedet, right? But it actually has the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Now, that's very popular in the English sense. Now, notice how linguistics, when we talk about Amharic study, it's not just to conversate. Because before you can get to the point of conversating, you have to get in the mind. You have to understand, well, how does this people think? You understand? How do our sovereign people, you understand, thing. Not that all of them acting, careless Ethiopians, not acting sovereign, they're acting, in some sense, like the worst kind of slaves, some of these careless Ethiopians, but that's there's a lot of brothers and sisters amongst them that are trying to work that out. You understand? We have to work with our host, with our people, you understand, and then to fellowship with other Ethiopian, other progressive, like-minded Ethiopians, like especially the monarchists, the Ethiopian monarchists. You understand? And even many of our 12 tribe brothers and sisters as well, because they have done worthily overall from what we can see that Jah would expect for us to be doing compared to others who was like they were asleep, more to speak. But that's the derisive sense of speaking. But anyway, it says to lift up. So the idea is that the Lord giveth, he giveth, and he lifts up. That's so interesting. The Lord gives and he lifts up. But we have in translation, the Lord gives and he takes away. So we get the idea like he's snatching something away. No. He's actually lifting up. In fact, in the scripture, when the Lord snatches something away, it's always like when he grabbed Ezekiel's locks, and he snatched him away, right, to show him something. It's like when it says that man-child will be grabbed, snatched up to the throne, metaphysically, like we'll have to lich teferi, and that's in Revelation right there, speaking about the man-child, how he was snatched to God into his throne. So, or we have it in the sense, a different sense. You understand? When one is kind of kind of taken on that level to be snatched, you know, because that's what it says about Hizkiel. And we was in the book of Hizkiel for two major reasons, but one of them was concerning the Valley of the Dry Bones. Ezekiel chapter 37. Chapter 37, it speaks to all of this skull and bones, and not just the white folks' skull and bones, but what's happened with these Negroes. I mean, where did you get off or get on? Where did you get off of Zion train and you got on Babylon bandwagon? I mean, where? At what point, you know, did that happen? We say it was civil rights. But anyway, the Lord, he giveth and he taketh away. Very interesting. Give, and it's almost like shumshar. Shumshar, Bamarinya, in the imperial government and in the court, and even to be in the society of His Majesty, one is given an appointment or given a certain task. You understand? If one cannot do that task, and the task is necessary to the community, that position needs to be taken away, and maybe something else one can do better. You understand? That in itself is basic organization, you know? One of the areas of problems in mixed up moods and attitudes is that one still have unrefined feelings and emotions and byproducts of other programs and still are plugged in even unconsciously, are still being hacked in because they haven't been born again. You see what I'm saying? They haven't been born again. They have not gone through that process. You know, as you say, where do I begin? You begin with prayer, with study, with receiving actions of, do you really accept this word of the King of Kings, the Bible? Do you really accept the testimony of the martyrs and the faithful Ethiopians, Hebrews, and even righteous Gentiles concerning, do you accept the testimony of His Majesty? And if you do, well, be about it. You know, and the Torah portion readings and feedings, they provide a way, an indigenous native way for I and I. We are reclaiming this. You understand? We are reclaiming this to ourselves. So, this particular portion, the 35th weekly Torah portion, Parsha, and Wendem Oludare, I want to just hail you up, give thanks for a text reminder. Brothers and sisters, you know, the whole Twitter and I don't know if you'll do the Twitter or whatnot like that, so forth and so on. We would hope we would have ones and ones that we can put that trust in. Say, all right, you be IT manager for the society. You take care of this responsibility or that responsibility. You understand? And ones to regularly report. And that's, but see, if we don't have the esprit de corps, it's only the Holy Spirit that can bring us to that level. While we're still plugged in, you know, here and there, and consciously unaware, then, you know, we continue to have these like one step forward, two step backwards sort of misbehaviors. But this portion, the annual Hebraic cycle of the Orit Minbar, Torah readings, this is the second portion in the book of Numbers, right? Second portion in the book of Numbers, right? So it constitutes Numbers chapter 4, verse 21 to Numbers chapter 7, verse 89. They said NASO or Bamarinya in His Majesty's Metzhaf Kedus, the authorized Amharic Bible of the King of Kings, right? The authorized, the imperial translation, you know, should we say. It's Wissed. You know, and Wissed, you could tell, Wissed, right? And it's the longest of the 54 weekly Torah portions with 176 verses. It's long. Now, we as Hebrews, black Jews, and even other Jews, you understand, but we in the diaspora generally read it in late May or June. And here we're at the 14th point. You know how the 14, 28, the moon cycle, the feminine period. So we're at the half point, you understand, of this, and here we are reading it. Now, here it touches on like the Hanukkah memorial right here. And it says, as the Parsha includes the story of the consecration of the tabernacle, so the holy place was consecrated. Hebrews and Jews also read parts of the Parsha as Torah readings on the 8 days of Hanukkah, right? So it touches on, this portion is connected also with Hanukkah, which is the festival of lights, right? But we're going to skip over that for right now, and we can put a note for that this portion, good for Hanukkah, you understand? Or which really should be the way that so-called Kwanzaa is made righteous and truly holy. If you make that connection, you should make that connection. That connection's already there. We've put out some words on it, but others also need to get involved in this campaign. Sovereign people know that they only have to be told, but maybe encouraged. Parsha addresses priestly duties, purifying the camp, and the wife accused of unfaithfulness, what's known in the Hebrew as the sota. The Nazarite, the priestly blessing, and the congregation, or the consecration, you could, of the dinquan of the tabernacle, consecrating the tabernacle. Now, these are the areas right here. It speaks on the priestly duties, the duties of the priest. And if you look over the past videos between this video, this portion for this 35th, and the last one for the 34th, and even this whole period of time, we've been speaking on the priestly. Not that one is putting on clothing to walk out on the street as priests. If you notice something, that the priests, when they're in public, they change their clothing. Notice that too. There's a change of garments. They're given two kinds of garments. They're given the holy garment, and then they're given their regular garments. So a lot of that kind of playing dress up on a certain level, you know, overdoing it in public is facetious, and it's not really walking in the. But there is clothing that we have to touch on. The whole clothing idea is so very important. But this is what we need. You all in the community to really work together, and those who are able to take responsibility. You know, I mean, there's some individuals who know that the clothing, the whole clothing part, and you might have your own whatever businesses. You see, that does not offend I and I. This line of Jew society is not like I and I business. It's I and I father's business. It's John's business. I already told you with the theater and the translations and the playwriting, you know, and I like to playwright, you understand? You know, playwriting and stuff. That's what we would like to do, and maybe art and some other things, so forth, and music, of course, you know, on that sort of a level. So I'm saying this to say that we need to network, but we also need to approach networking maturely. You know what I'm saying? Because some ones are kind of thin-skinned. You know what I mean? Open rebuke is better than secret love. If I'm saying something that and you think from all your looking over it, it's wrong, say it's wrong, break down the point, bring your evidence, let me look at it. It might be wrong. I say, wow, give thanks. I will love you to life and eternal life for that. You understand? However, sometimes one, this is iron sharpened iron. You said if you correct the fool, you understand, they will hate you. But if you correct the wise man, he will love you. I'm not saying we should stop correcting. I'm saying that because of certain recent and even past encounters, as we seek him to work more with other brothers and sisters, you know, in a collective community sense. After some of our last experience, I said, listen, I mean, I could do it just if I want to hang out, you know, but there's more things to do than just hang out. You know, I mean, something has to be progressive about something, because there's ones and ones have families and children, and then, you know, we don't have no school, no institution. I mean, even just a tent, you know, Rastafari Yeshiva tent, you know, where ones come on a regular basis, teach what we need to be taught. So even in the wilderness, our people and children are being prepared for the promised land, for Africa, for Ethiopia. You understand, to join the family of so-called nations, you understand, with their birthright, you understand, nationality, and in their true name. You know, people say, well, it's about money, it's about getting those papers, so forth and so on, rah, 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 rah. It's about getting papers, but the reason why you can't get real papers is because you don't understand what governs the other papers, or even the background of the papers that you're getting. You see, so you're approaching that whole thing with ignorance. That means you're under a spell. You don't know what it's about. Like, you know, a person, I'm under a spell. You know, they do you know you're under a spell? And they might say, yeah, they know they're under a spell, but they're inert, as Morpheus says. And inert is the opposite of movement. You see, we say, what happens in Rastafari movement? Inertia has somehow crept into I matrix. And you know, the matrix is the womb. Think about that for a moment. The womb is the matrix. But not just the womb of the individual female, but the birthing process of new sons and daughters. So that if we are born in our birth right and not birth wrong, you know, or getting a counterfeit to the teaching of His Majesty, you know, other things that sound nice, you know what I mean? And they probably are okay, but it's not really it's not in the proper order, accountability. See, numbers also tells you what is first, second, third, fourth, fifth. You know, you can prioritize affairs. So it's not that we have challenges that can't be overcome, whether it's with the Federation, Ethiopian World Federation, whether it's with repatriation, whether it's with the land grant or establishing other communities in addition to the Jamaican Sefer, like a Afro-American Sefer, or have a Lion of Judah Sefer, or other, you know what I mean? I mean, all this is doable. But the first thing is not no one stopping us, but we must take personal responsibility so that we can come together. The unity is not one person's responsibility only. It's really that we have the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Spree, the core. So it's people in priestly duties, purifying the camp. Perhaps this is metaphysically a manifestation of the call that we need to purify I camp. And not looking at somebody else. Oh, yeah, I seen that brother over there. You check yourself first. We all spend time and make that the message. You know, make that the message, not just for someone else, but we do it ourselves. The camp will be pure. The camp will be like, wow, Rastafari is, you know, I think about Michelle Obama said the first time she's proud of America. For Rastafari said the first time I was proud to be a Rastafari. I don't know how to take that, but it'll be interesting. Anyway, next is the wife accused of unfaithfulness of Sultan. Now, I know a lot of people thinking like, yeah, some of these gals, some of these sisters, some of these women like this and that. And people say, well, what about you, Ross? You just did that video on Rihanna and you called woman of wickedness. How would she feel about that? I don't really care how she feel about that. Something to spark up. You know, she'd be rolling these blunts and singing a little Bob Marley here, there, Bob Marley. You know, I mean, they really have to, you know, make the decision. They still can. You know, Jah, His Majesty Christ, our Black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, is stronger than everything that's holding all of those lost sheep up there in the music or whatever. It's just a matter of whether they're willing. You know what I mean? It's a matter. They obviously believe or have more faith, you understand, in what they're doing than in what I is saying and then in what Jah word is revealing, even on a daily basis. That's what. And it's not for you to say, oh, yeah, that's why I don't like them. Not meant to. Get off those emotions. I pointed that 50 Cent song when he says, that nigga's emotional. You know what I mean? And I say, we need a song like that. Because like we're getting emotional about certain things instead of really, you know, looking at it spiritually. You understand? Looking at it spiritually. Because emotion is the heart chakra level. It is the soul. You understand? We have to be in that upper room. You see, and when we're in that upper room, we come to see things, as I said from the beginning, see things the way Jah says it, the way Christ says it, and then we see why the holy and the faithful took a certain righteous course. It doesn't seem crazy to us anymore why some ones and ones took that holy, the holy course. Some of them may have been martyred for it. Some of them have been overcomers in it. All of them are overcomers. You understand? Or why His Majesty took the particular course he did, why we can say that that righteous generation that was able to stand up to Antichrist, you understand, in 1930, you know, the 1930s and in the 40s, and to have that victory. You always, but the woman or the wife that's accused of unfaithfulness of the Sultan, if you overstand in Christ with that veil off of your eyes, you know who the Sultan is. It might be some individual sisters here and there, and there's a lot of folly going on, even among the men and the women. Baby mama drama, baby deadbeat baby father. I mean, if that should make you want to be born again. You know, seeing that sort of situation, especially if you've been involved in it like many of us have, to be born again. But getting beyond that in Christ, getting past the basic elementals. The elemental will tell you it's a wife and what is done to the individual wife. But here, speaking of a church, once again, is looking at us as a movement, as a collective people. We are like a bride. We are like a collective woman. It's like there's a verse in the scripture, I think it's Hosea. Hosea says, like, I will not punish your wives, your woman or your wives when they commit. I don't want to teach this because, you know, sister, I'm not trying to, some of y'all might be like, that's right, that's what I was saying. Sister, I want to do a separate vid than this. So if there's ones out there, maybe you can edit this into a portion itself, a little message to the sisters. But I don't want you to take it the wrong way. Keep this in accordance with what we are learning. So if you just click on this for the first time, and somebody else say, yeah, you got to really check this out, man, you know, you might get it from a undisciplined perspective. You might be looking at it from a worldly perspective. So some of this you might not really get quite correctly. Because right here it is speaking to I think this is Hosea chapter 2. And let me look at the portion, the Torah portion. The Torah portion, if you look at the Torah portion from the 34th, right, the 34th, which is Hosea chapter 2, verses 1 to chapter 2, verse 23. So if you look at it from 1 to 23, I did touch on this a couple of days earlier. There's a particular verse where he says that he will forgive the woman, you know, the woman some of these things, because in Jah's mind, the men have much more responsibility, Yehovah's, and it basically says that if we put matters right, a lot of these things that we're seeing, even among our sister and woman, not saying that there's not some bad gals out there, I mean, but then they'll be seen much better. We'll be able to see the forest for the trees. We can't see nothing now, you know, because we're all caught up in all these mixed up moods and attitudes and emotionalism and ignorance. I mean, ignorance and emotionalism, what a combination. You're good to people, because some of you probably know where this verse is for some reason. Oh, right here. My bad. It was chapter 4. My bad. Chapter 4, verse 14, where it says, I will not punish your daughters when they commit whoredom, nor your spouses. This is heavy to say, bros, you know. But then it's saying to us bros, there may be a reason for the holes. I know this might be a little bit too much for some. But Jah is saying that he will not punish your daughters when they commit whoredom, nor your spouses when they commit adultery. This is just a portion of the clip. It's not doctrine. Let's just talk about what Jah is saying. For themselves are separated with whores. Wow. Because for they themselves are separated. Now, some say that's interpreted to mean, you can interpret, get the interpretive of that, that is saying that Jah is saying in this instance, because it's saying the idolatry of Israel. And when we say the idolatry of Israel, we're looking at now even at that woman of wickedness, that symbol that in the Rihanna vid, and what's going on out there, and this whole demoralization of the divine feminine and of the feminine. So remember that the old saying is, the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. So now, if this Sota is not just an individual woman, but it's Babylon. So Babylon is that Sota. Wow. The hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. They say it's a man's, well, that's a joke. You understand? Because a white man, the European, he's destroyed masculinity. He's destroyed it. And if you're living in the image of the white man, like a lot of Negroes, blacks, and colors are doing, then in a sense you're being destroyed little incrementally. You're being incrementally down, destroyed, or destroyed. But Jah is saying, they sacrifice with harlots. Therefore, the people that doth not understand shall fall. Therefore, the people that doth not understand shall fall. So the people who don't give a damn and don't want to understand are going to fall. You know, some people look at what's going on with Negroes, that the hard-headed Negroes don't want to listen. I'm not saying to rejoice over their fallenness, but that's not our problem. It's not. Yeah, you feel sorry for their background in life, but there's so many people's background in life that if you really look at it, you can feel sorry for everybody. And in a sense, that's why there's Jah. That's why there's Yeshua. Jesus Christos. You can't really reach out to everyone, you understand, as an individual. You first have to get your Godhead, your God connection, and say, Jah, what can I do about this? But you're all running after your emotions, so forth and so on. And we want to speak against all this little emotionalism, because that causes, you know, those mixed-up moods and attitudes, the kind of thing where folks say, I don't want to deal with so-and-so because, you know, and going on with this emotion. And they understand that right there is like a virus that they haven't expunged. You understand? So it says even here in 11, whoredom, wine, new wine, take away the heart, right? And so Jah is saying, though thou, Israel, play the harlot, yet let not Judah offend. Although a lot of our Israelitish lost sheeples are playing the whore with this Babylonian thing, this New World Order, this satanic world order thing, right? It says, let not Yehuda, Judah offend. Some of us, when we look at Judah, we see Ethiopia as representing that Judah equation. We as the lost sheep over here, you understand, but that identity was stripped from us under Negro, Black, Colored, Artificial Person, 13th, 14th Amendment. This is why you have to reclaim, you understand, your name. Yet let not Judah offend, and come not ye to Gilgal, neither go up to Beth Aven, nor swear the Lord liveth. It's like saying, don't let these ones be trying to act like them righteous, saying, Jah live, you know, like, and see, that a lot of that has crept in. If you look at the Rastaism, that's crept in. He's saying, although those black people who want to live in the image of the beast are the way they are, don't let those who now recognize that truth now offend. That means bring into Rastafari, in a sense, the immorality of the world. You understand? And then you want to say, Jah live. Like, then you want to, you know, almost like sing, you know, you want a fellowship, but we're not really fellows. You see, that's what that's that mixed multitude thing, again, that we should learn something from in the scripture. So I just point to that part right there. I'll go into a little more detail on it. And it's not saying that, and it's not a license for sisters or women or men or men and women or women and men to commit immorality. But what he's saying is, it's like they're all infected. They're all dirty. You know what I mean? And there's no cleanness there. You know, so it's almost like saying that I've seen this kind of situation where some Rasta men had sisterins, and, you know, they would go out to the club. You know what I mean? Hang out at the club and, you know, the strip joint and stuff. And I'm not saying that one should say they do not like the females, you know, but it's kind of interesting, because from some situations I've seen like that, many of the women were trying to learn more and grow in Rastafari, and these dudes were out there chasing ball heads, and Jah may have blessed them for business or something like that, even a hustle, you know what I mean, where they was making a pretty good penny, but then they were using it on vanity. They were paying these money out to these Babylonian holes for some kind of, you know, strange, you know, for some, it's like it was a worship, really. You know what I mean? Call it booty worship, ass worship. It's still worship. Think about it. So it's when you put that on your number of things at first, above Jah. I mean, just something to think about, because even I myself also have to think about these things and pray for more strength. But then his, this one particular situation, no names right here, it's interesting because I saw the sister also. The sister, over time, being affected by this, and she knew that her brethren was, you know, her baby father, brethren, a man, I can't say husband or wife, because we haven't gotten to that level of civilization again, have we? She began, it's like, I saw how that infected her. So now somebody might look at her, I don't know what happened to her to this very day. I'm not going to name no names, but there's a couple of cases like this. And my personal case previous, you know, seemed to be a little different than this. Because here you had a Rastafari couple, you know, they said admittedly Rastafari couple. And the woman was trying to maintain, you know, faithfulness, and if it said put on a dress, and she wore tight pants, or she put on a dress, if it said tie your hair back, she tied her hair back, if it said read the Bible, she even read the Bible, may not understood much of it, so read the Bible, maybe, you know, wanted to read them for a man, but the man was out there because his locks were long, he got a new rod, a new whip, something like that, all these skanks, holes, skettles, like the image of the woman of wickedness, similar to what that image that Rihanna, a lot of these, Janet Jackson, the rest of them are projecting out there, even in the Beyonce and the music industry. Mad Ona in Hebrew means like sex. Ona, that word right there. But we'll get into that. But Mad Ona, that's my little, get it? Yeah. Anyway, he was running after that sort of type. And he was also spending the blessings of Jah. I'm talking about, like, you know, doing a little hustle, do a little business, have a little shop that was in Rastafari name, in other words. And this was at a time when there was a lot of blessings out there, and ones got blessed. It's almost like we asked Jah, bless me, and Jah blessed I and I, and then look what was done with a lot of it, a lot of those same blessings.